Because today, we're gonna dissect a film by Nina Paley. Nina Carolyn Paley was born May 3rd, 1968 in Urbana, Illinois. She was raised Jewish atheist and graduated high school in 1986. She then went to the University of Illinois to study art, but dropped out after 2 years and moved to California. There, she started her first major work, Nina's Adventures. A lot of the strips either dealt with aspects of Nina's personal life or embodied your standard run-of-the-mill 90s feminist and anti-consumerist messages.
This tape player doesn't work.
Maybe it's like that on purpose.
Why would anyone make a defective product on purpose?
Simple. Employee sabotage. See, the capitalists who own the company that manufactured your tape player exploit the employees who actually do the work. They're trapped by economic necessity, slaving for the man on degrading, meaningless production line tasks. Messing things up is one of the only ways a worker can express dissatisfaction. In a system where almost all their power and dignity is stripped away from them, sabotage can make a difference. So when you open that crappy product, when that appliance breaks as soon as you plug it in, when the goods you purchase are riddled with gaping, conspicuous flaws, it means another blow has been struck for the revolution!
I still want my money back.
Sure, I only work here.
The strip actually ran on some newspapers until it ended in 1999. A few years later, she teamed up with fellow cartoonist Stephen Hirsch for the much less political comic, The Hots. It featured a young married Jewish couple and lasted under a year. Around this time, Paley began to shift her focus to animation, which she had started really experimenting with in 1998. She's also super problematic! Paley is a TERF, or a gender critical feminist, as they prefer to be called. I won't dive too deeply into TERFs because content creators much better than me have already discussed them in depth.
I have a playlist of them. The link is in the description below.
To put it simply, TERF is an acronym for Trans Exclusionary Radical Feminist. They think gender is solely based on biological sex. Spoiler alert, it's not! They don't think trans women are quote-unquote real women. Spoiler alert, they are! And they consider anything gender-affirming to children grooming. Spoiler alert, what the fuck is wrong with you?! Paley has talked a lot about her views on gender and was one of the people who signed that letter saying J.K. Rowling is based or whatever, and the people taking issue to her blatant transphobia are involved with hate speech or something. Paley even spoke out against people canceling her on a prestigious feminist news outlet. That's right, Newsmax!
Woke corporations are at it again, this time attempting to cancel the publication of a politically incorrect comic that ironically pokes fun at cancel culture itself.
We'll show you the emails that were received from by feminist cartoonist Nia Paley. She received from crowdsourcing platform Indiegogo informing her that the campaign for her comic Agents of HAG was being suspended for violating her terms of service after the campaign reached 150% of its initial goal. So because of canceling, all the funds were refunded to those who didn't donate. So where does that leave the comic, obviously? We'll bring her on.
Nia Paley is a feminist cartoonist, animator, and the creator of Behind the Agents of HAG comic. An acronym there, humorous acronym GAG, H-A-G. Nina, thanks so much for coming on. We appreciate that. So we'll show some of
these. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely.
It also shouldn't come as surprising that beef-eating cook Jordan B. Peterson is a fan of hers and sang praise to her in an extended interview.
So I'm talking today with Nina Paley, who's a brilliant animator, and she's making a variety of short films, which I guess are going to be joined together into a longer film about that feature Old Testament themes. And she's the creator of the animated musical feature Sita Sings the Blues. More recently, she made This Land Is Mine, which is an absolutely brilliant, shocking, devastating, and also aesthetically impressive.
A word of advice. If you call yourself a feminist but continuously align yourself with conservative people, you are not a feminist! She also drew Nina's Adventures comics for her more controversial beliefs, aside from the transphobia, that is. For example, she is a supporter of VHEMT, or VEMT. What is VEMT? Well, it's the Voluntary Human Extinction Movement, of course! And they preach... Oh no. Yeah, I'm going to just save VEMT for another video. I've been wanting to do one on antinatalism for a while anyway.
Just because you think having kids is bad does not make you a good person! Shut the fuck up!
Now that you have a basic understanding of Nina Paley, we can now talk about the work that put her on the national stage, Sita Sings the Blues. Paley started work on Sita Sings the Blues after a messy divorce. She details it in the film proper, so we'll go over the nitty-gritty a little later. But Paley discovered Indian epic the Ramayana during this time in her life, and, well, got inspired.
I was moved by the Ramayana, and it seemed to speak so much to my life at the time, my problems at the time. It was cathartic to retell the story.
The film was released in 2008 after years of development, and I'll admit, it's amazing. On a technical scale. Paley did the animation herself on her computer, and remember, computers at the time were mostly derpy-looking desktops that ran Windows XP. And considering all the factors, the film is technically good. Like, look at how stylized and fluid this animation is. It looks like something a studio would put out, not a lonely white woman using Flash on her dual 1.8 gigahertz tower. I have no idea what that means, but my friends tell me animating a movie on that kind of computer is impressive, so. Now, in regards to its content, Sita Sings the Blues is controversial. Why? Well, this film could be considered cultural appropriation. And I can see that, like a white lady making her own interpretation of a work by a commonly marginalized group in the United States, I'd be pissed too. But when I watched the film, I realized that not only was it a form of cultural appropriation, Nina gets things blatantly wrong about the source material. Like, to the point where I'd argue it could be classified as fan fiction. So let's invade the turf of a turf and rip this baby a new one. But first, for those of you who are new, I usually have a set of rules and disclaimers before the meat of my video. This is for two reasons: to get the lawyers off my back and to emphasize my creatorial intent. We'll start with the disclaimer this time. Y'all at home might be thinking, wait a second, did Flower give money to a transphobe?
Am I giving money to a transphobe?
Let me alleviate your fears. Nina Paley released this movie for free. In fact, she originally released it under the same license most of my videos are under, the Creative Commons Attribution Sharealike license. It's at the end of most of my videos, if you're curious. And it means you can do with this material whatever you want for free, as long as one, you give credit, and two, put your derivative content under the same license. I'm technically giving Nina credit by mentioning that she made this, and I'm
sharing it under the same license. Were she to claim this video, that would make her more of a hypocrite than she already is, wouldn't it? She's most likely not gonna enforce it anyway. She doesn't seem to care about the film's copyright anymore, as far as I know. The movie's also available for free online because of this license. I didn't give Nina a single rupee, and neither are you. Anyway, let's get to the rules. One, I try to get as much of an understanding of the Ramayana as possible. There are many versions of the story, and I'm not even close to having the full picture. I did what I could. Please don't get mad at me if I get some details wrong, okay? Two, as a result, Ramayana characters are known under a large variety of names. I used the most common translations that I was able to find, but if a different name for a character is mentioned, I'll let you know who they're talking about. Three, as always, do not harass anyone I mention in this video. Nina's a terrible person, I know, but I don't want y'all dogpiling on her, okay? It'll just make you look bad if you do that. Four, and remember, any and all comments degrading me or others, especially trans and gender non-conforming people, will be deleted and reported. Please, please behave yourselves in the comments, okay? Okay. And now, on with the show! Behold, a part of my bookshelf that is normally off-screen. Before you can understand my problems with Sita Sings the Blues, you must have a basic understanding of the Ramayana. The Ramayana is an Indian epic originally penned by the poet Valmiki sometime between the 8th and 4th century BC, with some estimating it to be as recent as 3rd century AD. It's kind of like the Odyssey or the Journey to the West of the region and has multiple versions. While it's often recognized as a Hindu epic, it also has Jainist and Buddhist adaptions. The story also traveled all across Southeast Asia, with versions exclusive to Cambodia, Thailand, and so on. It remains influential in South and Southeast Asian culture to this day. The original Ramayana would take me an hour to talk about in full, so here's a very abridged summary of the plot.
So once upon a time, there was this king named Dasharatha, who was childless and lonely, but that's soon going to change because of Vishnu. Vishnu is one of the most important gods in Hinduism. He's the supreme being, the god of preservation and time, the protector of good. The other gods pleaded to Vishnu to defeat Ravana, the demon king. Vishnu says he will reincarnate as Dasharatha's son, as a human is able to kill Ravana. He also has other gods reincarnate as monkeys because Ravana is destined to be destroyed by monkeys. I don't know either, just go with it. Anyway, Dasharatha is told by his mentor that he will arrange a sacrifice. He does, and a being emerges from the sacrifice to give Dasharatha rice. The being tells him to split the rice equally among his three wives, and they will have children. Guess what? It works! Kausalya has Rama, Kaki has Bharata, and Sumitra has the twins Lakshmana and Shatrughna. Rama is the most important one, obviously. He is the human incarnation of Vishnu, after all. Rama grows up, has some adventures, then meets Sita while traveling in a different city. Sita is a human princess and the incarnation of Lakshmi. Lakshmi is Vishnu's wife, the mother goddess, goddess of prosperity, fortune, power, beauty, and illusion. For Sita and Rama, it's love at first sight. Rama proves his worth to Sita's father by lifting and stringing a bow that once belonged to Shiva, the god of destruction. Rama and Sita marry, and everyone in the city comes to see, and it's very long, and I'm going to save the details. Sometime after the wedding, Dasharatha decides to abdicate in favor of Rama because, you know, he's getting old. Everyone is initially on board with it, but then Kaikeyi is approached by her hunchbacked companion, Kuni. Yes, the work emphasizes that Kuni's a hunchback, make that what you will. Kuni manipulates Kaikeyi and claims Dasharatha owes her two favors. She adds that Rama might just send her away once he's in power. Kaikeyi accosts Dasharatha and demands he not only make her son, Bharata king, but also banish Rama for 14 years. Dasharatha hesitates and calls her a demon, but he ultimately complies. He dies after he announces the exile from a broken heart. Rama complies with the exile and goes to the forest with Sita and Lakshmana. They encounter various sages, demons, and divine beings. Some are friendly, but some aren't. One of the unfriendly ones is Shupakana. Shupakana is Ravana's fellow demon sister. She falls head over heels in love with Rama and conspires to make him hers, but Rama isn't into her and demands she leave him alone despite various threats. When she doesn't, Lakshmana cuts her nose, ears, and breasts. Shupakana is pissed and pleads to Ravana to do something. She describes Sita to him and, say it with me, falls in love with her at first sight, or, well, first hallucination in this case. Ravana convinces his monk uncle to help him, and he does so by taking the form of a golden deer and prancing near Rama and Sita. Obviously, Sita asks Rama to capture the deer for her. Lakshmana sees through this bullshit, but Rama agrees and tells her to stay inside. But Sita is tricked into going outside and is kidnapped by Ravana! He immediately takes her to his demon kingdom to make her his bride. After various shenanigans, Rama and Lakshmana meet the
those monkeys from earlier. The monkeys, especially this one named Hanuman, agree to help Rama, but he has to help Hanuman and his brother Sugriva first. How? By helping Sugriva kill his enemy. Once that's done and Rama has some time to be sad, they set off with an army of monkeys to rescue Sita. Meanwhile, Sita keeps refusing Ravana's advances and stays loyal to Rama. Ravana's surprisingly cool about it. This isn't a joke, this isn't a bit, he was actually kind of cool about it. Anyway, after many trials and battles, Rama defeats Ravana and rescues Sita. He makes her undergo a purity test before he takes her back, which he unsurprisingly passes, because of course she's fucking does, you prick. They return home and are crowned as the king and queen. Overall, the Ramayana explores themes of righteousness, devotion, and the triumph of good over evil, and all that good shit. It also highlights the importance of loyalty, sacrifice, and the power of divine intervention.
Oh, fuck! That was longer than I thought. Fuck. Anyway, now we can discuss Sita Sings the Blues. The movie is split into vignettes, and I don't want to just describe what happens in vignette A, then B, then C. I'll explore all the plot lines one by one. First, I want to talk about the one vignette series I liked, the Shadow Puppets.
The Shadow Puppets are played by three actors from India. They're from different parts of the country and discuss their interpretations and thoughts on the Ramayana. And if the film was just these three talking, I probably would have liked it. I like hearing legends and folk tales from the people who are from the actual culture they represent. And these scenes show not only the legend's flaws, but also how different it can be from place to place. For example, in regards to Sita's kidnapping.
How she actually is able to tell these people where she drops her jewelry along the way, right?
Right.
And that's how they were able to find it. It went all the way up to Lanka.
How many times did she drop the jewelry?
She was wearing a lot of jewelry in the forest.
She loved jewelry.
I mean, no, she's not wearing any jewelry because she left everything before right. She left Ayodhya and she came.
Oh, she left everything?
Yeah, she did.
Right, she just came in her sannyasi clothes.
Don't challenge these stories.
Yes, Sita et al. Abandoned their wealth and dressed in peasant clothes before they started their exile. Sita then eventually uses jewelry, which she wasn't supposed to have, to lead a trail to Ravana's kingdom. But depending on the translation or abridgment you read, they explain how Sita got the jewelry.
Some of the first beings Sita, Rama, and Lakshmana meet during their exile were the great sage Athri and his wife, Anusuya. Anusuya gave Sita her nice fabric and jewelry.
She spoke the lady's meek reply, swelled Anusuya's rapture high. Sita, she said, my gift today, thy sweet contentment shall repay. Accept this precious robe to wear, of heavenly fabric, rich and rare, these gems thy limbs to ornament, this precious balsam, sweet of scent. O mightiest dame, this gift of mine, shall make thy limbs with beauty shine, and breathing o'er thy frame dispense, its pure and lasting influence. This balsam on thy fair limbs spread, new radiance on thy lord shall shed, as Lakshmi's beauty lends a grace to Vishnu's own celestial face. Then Sita took the gift the dame bestowed on her, in friendship's name, the balsam, gems, and robe divine, and garlands wreath of bloomy twine, then sat her down with reverence meet at saintly Anasuya's feet.
But again, your mileage may vary depending on what you're reading.
Again, I seriously wish it was just these three talking. I love them. I'll have a video up on Flower Gothic 2 that's just these segments, so you can check them out on your own. One of the plot lines in this film, as I've said before, deals with Nina Paley's breakup with her husband, Dave. They start off living happily in San Francisco, but Dave grows distant once he accepts a 6-month job contract in India. He continues to be distant when Nina joins him in India, then dumps her via email when she's at a conference in New York. Nina's heartbroken, but finds solace in the Ramayana.
It's written to try and make us sympathize with Nina. Her husband suddenly grows distant. He dumps her for seemingly no reason. Just like Rama when he did that purity test bullshit.
But if life has taught me anything, breakups are rarely black and white like that. I highly doubt Dave started being distant the moment he stepped foot in India. And I must ask, why did Dave take the India job? Like, really, why? Was it because he was already growing distant from Nina? Did their relationship have problems before he accepted the job offer? On top of that, Why didn't Nina go with him in the first place? Sure, their home is in San Francisco, but she sublets the place anyway after a month of no
alleged
contact! She could have easily gone with him in the first place! Like, what the hell? We don't actually see the breakdown of Nina and Dave's relationship. It's more like a, first they were happy, now they're not, kind of writing. And putting aside Nina's bullshit views, I'm not invested in her enough to care. And also, what's Dave's side of the story? What caused him to fall out of love with Nina? What happened with him? Sadly, I don't think we'll ever know. The reenactments really piss me off for multiple reasons, but most glaringly, it's obvious Nina was using the story to process her breakup. Now, I'm for immersing yourself in something to cope with tough emotions. I'm for creating shit to cope with tough emotions. Hell, I'm guilty of both! But when you use something from a culture that's not your own and release something that is your own white-ass interpretation of that story because you got dumped, I'm sorry, the vibes aren't right.
The vibes, they be rancid!
In all honesty, it feels like Nina is telling this story like it's a fairy tale, and not with the seriousness people who are familiar with the legend and Indian culture expect. That isn't to say adaptions that take artistic liberties are bad. One adaption of the story I really like is called Ravan. Ravan is a modernized adaption of the legend told in Ravana's perspective. It plays into the interpretation he's more of a troubled anti-hero rather than a straight-out villain. In fact, the shadow puppets Nina hired discussed this interpretation to some extent.
But he was an incredibly learned man. From what I understand, Ravana was... Actually, the only bad thing he seems to have done is capture Sita, like kidnap Sita, which is kind of interesting because like everything else about him seems to be like he's this really learned guy. He knows all these weapons. He prays to the right gods, I guess. So all this stuff. And he's like this good king, except that over time, we've been led to believe more and more that he's this complete, like he's like Mogambo. Commending Ravan for not forcibly... I mean, I know we shouldn't commend somebody for that.
What if he raped her?
Yeah, but in terms of villains, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we expect villains to be villainous.
Yes.
This is a guy that's like, if you don't come to me willingly, I will not touch you.
Right.
I will not force you in my house.
Right.
I will not force myself on you.
In Ravan, Ravana isn't a demon, but rather the leader of a Naxalite gang. What is a Naxalite? Short answer, they're Marxist-Leninist-Maoists. Long answer is over half a decade of geopolitical conflicts that we really don't have the time to get into. TLDR, the Naxalites have been revolting against the Indian government since 1967. Anyway, human Ravana is the leader of a Naxalite gang. He kidnaps Sita, who is married to a superintendent of the Indian National Police. The story diverts at Sita and Ravana's relationship. Sita, in the original legend, remained faithful and refused to sleep with Ravana. In Ravan, Sita ultimately falls in love with Ravana. Whether or not it's Stockholm Syndrome is up to interpretation, as well as whether you think Stockholm Syndrome is a real phenomenon. Sita ends up leaving Rama for Ravana, but tragically, Rama kills Ravana at the end, leaving Sita distraught. The film received mixed reviews and was a box office bomb, but not because of the source material. Instead, it was from legitimate criticisms, particularly the film's pacing. But I enjoyed it! The leads had a lot of chemistry. Unsurprisingly, they're married in real life, and I thought the pacing was fine! It even had transgender representation. Sure, it was 2010, so their representation was garbage, but they weren't afraid to include a trans character, Nina! But aside from the way this story is told, Nina also leaves out significant aspects of the story that add context or characterization. Here are the ones I complied. First, Lakshmana is completely omitted from the story. Remember how I said he went with Rama and Sita into exile and helped Rama out a lot? Yeah, he just, like, doesn't show up. And he plays an important role in Sita's kidnapping. While Rama is out hunting the golden deer, Sita and Lakshmana hear screams outside. While Sita fears Rama is in danger, Lakshmana believes they're fake. They argue about this until the latter reluctantly agrees to go and check on Rama.
Lakshmana tried to set her mind at rest. You have apparently not understood the nature of Rama. There is no power which can reduce him to cry for help. If Rama was really threatened, the whole universe and all creation would have trembled and collapsed by now, for he is no ordinary mortal. Sita's eyes flashed in anger and sorrow. It's improper for you to stay here with me and talk coldly this way. Strange, strange. Anyone who has been close to my lord for even a brief moment ought to be prepared to lay down his life for him. Yet you, who were born and bred with him and attached yourself to him through everything, you stand here unmoved and unaffected by his cry for help. If you don't want to save him, there is nothing more I can do, nor anyone I could turn to for support. The only thing left will be for me to build a fire and throw myself into it. Sita's insinuations and lack of trust in him pained Lakshmana deeply. He pored over her words and said, "No need for you to harm yourself. I only shudder at the import of your words. I'll obey you now. Do not be anxious. This very second I'll leave. I only hesitated because your order goes against the command of my brother. I'll go, and may the gods protect you from harm."
Ravana then accosts Sita while she's alone and kidnaps her! And Sita sings the blues, though. Ravana just takes her while she's still inside. More confusingly, the retellings imply she went outside anyway.
She's gone. I told her not to leave the hut. Oh, how will I ever find her?
So, what the fuck? Remember how Kaikeyi was gaslit into kickstarting the main plot? Well, here it was out of her own volition, and she really is that evil, guys!
Rama, my son. Today I wish to crown you king of Ayodhya. But my evil, scheming wife, Kaikeyi, just reminded me of an ancient vow I made.
Oh, those women! Those evil, scheming women with their... Okay, I got nothing. As I said, Kaikeyi was manipulated by Kuni into what she did. The shadow puppets don't mention Kuni's role at all, and she might not even appear in some versions of the legend, but they don't imply Kaikeyi was manipulating her husband at all. At the very least, she was just naive enough to request her son to be crowned instead, and because favors in ancient India are sacred. So she got her wish. Another exclusion I don't understand is Shurpanaka's initial meetings with Rama et al. Firstly, remember that she was mutilated by Lakshmana after trying to court Rama? Again, for a feminist retelling, omitting that detail is weird, but it also doesn't make practical sense. One of the reasons Shurpanaka told Ravana about Sita was to get back at Rama for the whole mutilation thing. Yeah, some of Ravana's minions were slaughtered two in the original and the film, but why would Shurpanaka care about them? Like, when she told her brother what happened to her, he of course asked, "Why would Rama do such a thing to you?" And her response was,
"Rama has a woman who should be yours. If you win her, I fear all your present favorites will be thrown out. I also fear that you will surrender to her all your powers, valor, possessions, and conquests, and make yourself her abject devotee. Her name is Sita. I was so overcome by her beauty that I waited and watched for a chance and attempted to snatch her and bring her to you as a present."
Ravana expresses interest and asks his sister to describe Sita. This is how the scene is depicted in Paley's movie.
"She is the most beautiful woman in the world. Her skin is fair like the lotus blossom. Her eyes are like lotus pools. Her hands are like, lotuses. Her breasts like big, round, firm, juicy lotuses."
Nina Paley, what the fuck? Needless to say, Shurpanaka was much more poetic in her description of Sita in the legend.
And Rama has a large-eyed spouse, pure as the moon her cheek and brows, dearer than life in Rama's sight, whose happiness is her delight. With beauteous hair and nose the dame from head to foot has naught to blame. She shines the wood's bright goddess, queen of beauty in her noble mane. First in the ranks of women placed is Sita of the dainty waist. In all the earth mine eyes have ne'er seen female form so sweetly fair. Goddess nor nymph can vie with her, nor bride of heavenly chorister. He who might call this dame his own, her eager arms about him thrown, would live more blessed in Sita's love than Indra in the world above. She, peerless in her form and face, and rich in every gentle grace, is worthy bride, O king, for thee, as thou art meet her lord to be. I, even I, will bring the bride in triumph to her lover's side. This beauty fairer than the rest, with rounded limb and heaving breast, each wound upon my face I owe to cruel Lakshmana's savage blow. But thou, O brother, shalt survey her moon-like loveliness today, and common piercing shafts shall smite thine amorous bosom at the sight. If in thy breast the longing rise to make thine own the beauteous prize, up let thy bitter foot begin the journey and the treasure win. If, giant lord, thy favoring eyes regard the plan which I advise, up cast all fear and doubt away, and execute the words I say. Come, giant king, this treasure seek, for thou art strong and they are weak. Let Sita of the faultless frame be borne away and be thy dame. Thy host in Janathan who dwelt forth to the battle hide, and by the shafts of Rama dealt they perished in their pride. Dushan and Kara, breathe no more, lay low upon the plain. Arise, and ere the day be o'er, take vengeance for the slain.
See how poetic that is? How Shurpanaka doesn't just go, "She's a lotus, brother! Just fucking fuck her already!" She actually paints a beautiful picture of a beautiful woman, and I can see how Ravana fell for Sita. A side note, did you hear Shurpanaka talking about how slim Sita's waist is? Having a small waist was quite the beauty standard in the region at the time. It kind of floors me that Nina didn't bring that up instead of doing the whole lotus bullshit. Another side note, when I initially watched the film, I was so pissed off by the Shurpanaka scene that I had to take a break for like a day. One of the other parts Nina skipped over was the entire monkey saga. In the film, the entire saga goes like this.
I will help you.
Who are you?
I am Hanuman, the monkey of warrior, son of the wind.
I am Rama, prince of Ayodhya. Let us be allies.
I shall be your servant forever.
Now go, find Sita.
Rama's effort to find Sita was more complicated than what Pele is implying here. Rama didn't just task Hanuman into finding her. As I said before, he was taken to Hanuman's kingdom and met Sugriva, Hanuman's brother, and the Monkey King. Sugriva had his own problems to deal with, and Rama agreed to help him in exchange for the monkey army. I understand why Nina skipped this part. It's essentially a subplot that doesn't contribute much to the main narrative, but to gloss over Hanuman and Rama's actual meeting is weird. Hanuman fucking disguised himself at first because he didn't know if Rama was really, well, Rama. After all, if you were predestined to serve someone, wouldn't you want to make sure you're serving the right person? It was only after Rama proved his identity and helped Sugriva that Hanuman went and found Sita in Ravana's kingdom. Sita gives Hanuman one of her rings as a sign she is in Ravana's custody, and Hanuman burns down the entire kingdom. As you do. Okay, I think that's everything plot-wise that I wanted to talk about. Now we can get to the musical numbers! To emphasize Sita's feelings during the story, Pele uses recordings from the late Annette Hanshaw. Hanshaw was a jazz singer from 1926 to 1937 and recorded hits such as Big City Blues and Body and Soul. One thing that's important to note is the early days of popular music were very different than what we're used to today, and not just in content. In those days, artists didn't write their own songs. Songwriters would write and compose them, and all sorts of artists would sing them. For those of you familiar with the Great American Songbook, most of the songs in the book came from this system. The reason I bring this up is because the Hanshaw songs Paley uses were also recorded by other artists. Judy Garland did her own version of Mean to Me, Billie Holiday has her own recording of Moanin' Low, and the legend herself, Ella Fitzgerald, recorded her own version of I've Got a Feeling I'm Falling. So why use Hanshaw? Was it because her work is in the public domain? Was it because her recordings were just that good? The answer to both questions is no! Firstly, the songs were not in the public domain. Nina Paley thought they were, but they weren't. To explain why, I'll have to give y'all a quick lesson on copyright law. Most copyrighted works in the States fall under the Copyright Act of 1976. By most, I mean all works published since January 1st, 1928, as of this recording. Most of Hanshaw's career would not be under this law. But here's what Paley didn't know. While Hanshaw's songs were indeed in the public domain, the synchronization rights to Hanshaw's music was still under copyright. By synchronization rights, I mean using her music, Hannah Hanshaw's music that is, as the soundtrack to a moving picture. Paley couldn't afford the licensing fees the people who owned Hanshaw's recordings wanted. They ultimately agreed on a fraction of the original price, and Paley made it available for free online to get out of paying a shit ton to Hanshaw's estate. But the question is, why bother? If the rights were so difficult to get, why not just get other songs? Nina answers this very defensively.
Hanshaw's songs themselves inspired the film. There would be no film without those songs. Until I heard them, the Ramayana was just another ancient Indian epic to me. I was feebly connecting this ancient epic to my own experiences in 2002, but the Hanshaw songs were a revelation. Sita's story has been told a million times, not just in India, not just through the Ramayana, but also through American blues. Hers is a story so primal, so basic to human experience, it has been told by people who never heard of the Ramayana. The Hanshaw songs deal with exactly the same themes as the epic, but they emerge completely independent of it.
Nina! Those aren't Hanshaw songs! They are jazz standards! As I said before, the quality of Hanshaw's recordings isn't good either. Hanshaw's music has never been remastered, at least not to the standard we're used to. So it's somewhat unsettling to see these bright, high-def animations with this grainy-ass soundtrack.
When night is creeping and I should be sleeping in bed.
It's a contradiction I don't like. Let's compare those three songs I mentioned earlier, the ones that were recorded. Fuck! Let's compare those three songs I mentioned earlier between Hanshaw's recordings and Ella Fitzgerald's recordings. Yes, she also recorded all three of them.
Moan and low, my sweet man, I love him so, though he's mean as can be.
He's the kind of man. He's the kind of woman like me.
So mean to me, why must you be mean to me?
Gee, honey, it seems to me you love to see me crying. I don't know why.
I'm flying high, but I've got a feeling I'm falling.
Falling for nobody else.
You see how Ella's recordings are a lot cleaner? Hell, Nina, I'm willing it would have been cheaper than $50,000 to do your own renditions of the music. Then again, crowdfunding is very different now than what it was in like the 2000s. One final note before we actually get to the numbers. Henshaw hated her recordings. She retired because she hated show business.
What are you more proud of? Is there any particular selection, something along that line?
As a matter of fact, I disliked all of them intensely. I was most unhappy when they were released. I just often cried because I thought they were so poor. Mostly because of my work, but a great deal, I suppose, because of the recording. Many times it didn't sound at all the way I sang it, you know?
Mm-hmm. Annette, you don't seem to bear too much affection towards your, shall we call it, your very brief recording span. Am I correct in saying that?
I didn't hear what you said.
I said, you don't seem to bear too much affection towards the work that you turned out.
Oh, heavens no. I disliked the business intensely. I loathed it.
There's a bit of irony in a self-proclaimed feminist using a dead lady's recordings that she didn't even like to talk about her breakup. In fact, most people who know about Henshaw know her because of the Sita film. Sita Sings the Blues was released 23 years after her death. Anyway, I want to preface this by saying jukebox musicals can be hard to pull off. I know it can be tricky to assign meaning to a pre-established song because, well, the song already has its own meaning and interpretations. Those of you familiar with my older videos probably know shoehorning in a song for the sake of a song is a major pet peeve of mine. If a scene can be told in full before the song, don't use the fucking song! Nina does not heed that advice. I won't go over the scenes in depth as they're just companion pieces to the actual reenactment, but I want to show you how obvious it is Nina just used Henshaw songs because she could. Let's look at the scene where Rama and Sita start their exile. Listen to the lyrics of the song Pele uses here. Here we are.
I hate to think what might have been if we had never met. Why should I suppose that this could be? The weary days, the lonely nights are easy to forget, since I am here and you are here with me.
The lyrics don't match the plot of the Ramayana. Yeah, Sita willingly goes into exile with Rama, but she starts by wondering, what would life be like if we never met? That wouldn't be fun, would it? They're reincarnations of major Mary deities! They were destined to meet! I'll forgive this slight though, as Sita and Rama don't learn their divinity until the end. The chorus also alludes to their destined partnership, so it's okay, I'll forgive it this time.
Even while I waited, somehow, dear, I knew you'd find me, I'd find you.
The second song will not get that grace, though. It's played during the scene where Rama hunts a golden deer for Sita, the deer that was a trap from Ravana. What song is played? Well, it's, What Wouldn't I Do for That Man?
I'll never leave him alone. I'll make his troubles my own. I love that man as nobody can. I'm just no good when his arms are above me. What wouldn't I do for that man?
Sita sings she'd do anything for her man. Well, standing in the hut, watching him catch the deer for her. If I were doing the scene, I'd use You Wouldn't Fool Me, Would You? Given how the scene plays in the original work, Lakshmana would be there trying to get Sita to stay as they hear quote-unquote Rama screams, and it would end with this as Sita's being carried away.
Gee ho, I wish that we could be all alone. You wouldn't fool me, would you? Don't take advantage of me, 'cause I'm not fooling you.
To contrast, here's how the scene in Nina's film ends.
Leave him alone. I'll make his troubles my own. I love that man better than I do myself. I'm just no good when his arms are about me.
What couldn't I do for that man? Oh, there's not a thing I wouldn't do for my man.
See how my idea's better? Of course you do. You have good taste, after all.
The third song is Daddy, Won't You Please Come Home. It's played when Hanuman finds Sita in Ravana's kingdom. Sita calls Rama Daddy in this, that's all I'm gonna say.
Daddy, won't you please come home? I'm so lonesome.
The fourth song is Who's That Knockin', and it covers the epic battle between Rama and Ravana, with Lakshmana missing, of course. The song is more thematically appropriate, as it's in Sita's perspective and she's excited to see her husband again. Of course she's singing that it can't possibly be the milkman, the grocer, the butcher, and all the other careers you can only find now at your local grocery store. The sequence is well animated, too.
Knocking at my door, I know it can't be the mailman, the coal man, the ice man. Who always collects? I hope that it isn't that butter and egg man who writes out those checks.
And then we get to the purity test. Sita is tested by Rama in a test by fire to prove her purity. We went over this. Now, depending on the interpretation, Rama did this as either a bitchy move or because he was coerced to by his peers. Some translations also say Rama knew that Sita would pass the test and he did it for something something divinity something.
And like, this is the first real time Rama is doing something mean to Sita. He broke his back trying to rescue her this entire film. I'm not excusing his actions. I just don't think Mean to Me is the best song here. After all, Rama knew he was giving Sita a purity test. He wasn't like shocked that she passed, though your mileage on that last part may vary depending on translation.
Rama explained that he had to adapt to this trial in order to demonstrate Sita's purity beyond the shadow of a doubt to the whole world. This seemed like a rather strange inconsistency on the part of one who had brought back to life and restored to her husband a person like Sugriva's wife, who had been forced to live with Vali, and whom Rama commended as worthy of being taken back by Sugriva after Vali's death. In Sita's case, Ravana, in spite of repeated and desperate attempts, could not approach her. She had remained inviolable, and the fiery quality of her essentially being burnt out of the god of fire himself. As he admitted after Sita's ordeal, under these circumstances, it was very strange that Rama should have spoken harshly as he had done at the first sight of Sita, and subjected her to a dreadful trial.
As I said before, this scene could be interpreted as Rama having to deal with the human flaws of jealousy and chauvinism. And that scene where Rama is shocked to see the deities? That's literally just the scene where he and Sita learn they're actually reincarnations of divine beings.
Brahma the creator came forward to speak and addressed Rama thus. Of the Trinity, I am the creator. Shiva is the destroyer and Vishnu is the protector. All three of us derive our existence from the Supreme God and are subject to disillusion and rebirth. But the Supreme God who creates us is without the beginning or an end. There is neither birth nor growth nor death for the Supreme God. He is the origin of everything, and in him, everything is assimilated at the end. That God is yourself, and Sita at your side now is part of that divinity. Please remember that this is your real identity, and let not the fear and doubts that assail an ordinary mortal ever move you. You are beyond everything, and we are all blessed to be in your presence.
Contrast with the lyrics and animation of Mean to Me.
You're mean to me. Why must you be mean to me? You love to see me crying. I don't know why you treat me coldly each day in the year. Sweetheart, I love you. Think the world.
the Ramayana retelling ends with the happy couple's return to civilization. Sita sings If You Want the Rainbow, which is also slightly off because, again, Sita and Rama never broke up. Like, the one shitty thing he did was the purity test. Granted, he did other shitty stuff, but you have to keep the time period and culture in mind. Anyway, they're crowned and live happily ever after. Sure, we don't get the conclusion of Nina's story, but that's okay. All that matters is the main storyline is resolved nice and neatly. Oh, fucking hell!
So, it looks like Nina Paley did include that controversial last conda, and she added a 3-minute intermission in an 80-minute film to prepare us for it.
First off, Nina, I get you were trying to homage classical and Bollywood films with this, but your movie takes little inspiration from either. In fact, it just kind of seems like a non sequitur.
And guess what? I can do that too! I'm going to collect myself to describe, like, the last 20 minutes of this bullshit film. I'll be right back.
How can I go to that movie? I know. I'll say I've got to go to gyms to finish your science project. That's a good lie.
When you tell one lie, it leads to another. When you tell two lies to cover each other,
then you tell three lies. Oh, brother, you're in trouble up to your ears.
So you tell four lies to try to protect you.
Then you tell five lies so folks won't suspect you. Then you tell six lies, and then you collect a life full of worries and fears. Soon you lie and lie without even trying. Every lie you tell will keep multiplying. And you'll be suspected, rejected, disliked, and you should. When you lie, you're closing the door on everything good.
I'm not going to gyms, really. I just thought I'd go to a movie. I'll never lie again, honest.
That's good. Are you all right?
There's no such thing as a good lie. From the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Mormons.
I finally have proper wine glasses. Bite me. So the breakup that inspired this whole mess doesn't happen until the last part of the film, in both Nina and Sita's stories. It details the controversial seventh and final canda, or part, of the book. So what's it about?
Basically, Rama hears rumors that Sita willingly went with Ravana to his demon kingdom. He believes them, maybe, or just wants to solidify his status as king by doing what his subjects believe is the righteous thing to do, and banishes Sita. This time, she's pregnant with twins. She raises them alone in the forest and still teaches them to honor their father. Rama finds them later on, and he still doubts her purity and devotion. So Sita begs to be swallowed by the Earth Goddess, and well, she is. The two eventually reunite as their respective deities and live lives, I guess.
This kanda is controversial, not only in the general public's eye, but also by scholars. Many scholars believe that this kanda was added or edited years after most of the others, and thus don't consider it canon to the rest of the story. And there is some evidence to back this up.
In 2015, a copy of the Ramayana from the 6th century was found in a library in Kolkata, India's third largest city. An India Times journalist interviewed the scholars behind the discovery, who detailed the differences between the manuscript and the common, quote-unquote, canon Ramayana.
In this version of the legend, there are just 5 khandas, instead of the accepted 7. There is no Balakanda, the part that deals with Rama's childhood, or Uttarakanda. This Ramayana ends with the return of Rama and Sita from exile and his ascension to the Ayodhyan throne.
Another article published in 2016 on Indian news site scroll.in broke down the seventh kanda and added this tidbit about when it was written.
Scholars are more and more clear with more and more evidence to support their argument that the Bala and Uttarakandas are later additions to what we call the Valmiki text. Given the language and tone of these first and last books, they clearly come from a later linguistic and more importantly, a later theological period where Vishnu has become a deity who has avatars, a deity who acts in the world for the benefit of human beings. This he does by saving dharma in various ways, usually by killing those who perpetuate adharma, for example, Ravana.
Both articles also say there is evidence pointing to the first Kanda, the Balakanda, which again deals with Rama's childhood, being a later edition as well. And when I looked back at the translations I was using, I had to agree with them. Aside from the part in the sixth Kanda where the gods tell Sita and Rama they're divine, the first and seventh Kandas are the only parts that explicitly talk about divine intervention, fate, and the origins of Rama, Sita, Hanuman, and so on. In fact, as one scholar put it, you could argue that the omission of both these Kandas makes Rama look more, you know, human.
Rama in this version is more human than God, with follies like anger and failure.
On which translation you read, the Uttakanda will be presented as a part of the story, translated but with context about the origins, summarized or left out entirely. Neither the full nor abridged translation I used actually translated it. Instead, they left these notes.
I'm omitting a sequel which describes a second parting between Rama and Sita, with the latter delivering twins in the forest, and concluding with Rama and Sita leaving this world and returning to the home in the heavens. But this part of the story is not popular, nor is it considered to be authentic, but a latter-day edition of Valmiki's version. Kanban does not take note of the sequel, but concludes his tale on the happy note to Rama's return to Adadia, followed by a long reign of peace and happiness on Earth. And there I prefer the end my own narration.
The Ramayana ends, epically complete, with the triumphant return of Rama and his rescued twin to Ayodhya and his consecration and coronation in the capital of his forefathers. Even if the Ramayana story were not complete, the conclusion of the last canto of the sixth book, evidently the work of a later hand than Valmiki's, which speaks of Rama's glorious and happy reign and promises blessings to those who read and hear the Ramayana, would be sufficient to show that, when the verses were added, the poem was considered to be finished. The Uttarakhanda, or last book, is merely an appendix or a supplement and relates only events antecedent and subsequent to those described in the original poem.
I omitted the last sentence in that latter description because the translator doesn't provide evidence to back it up. He says, "Oh, Indian scholars unanimously think it's canon," which I hope what I've shown disproves.
So how does this relate back to Sita Sings the Blues? Nina Paley omits the Balakanda from her retelling, but leaves the Uttakanda intact. It's a weird choice, as the latter is much more contentious than the former. I mean, not all of the Balakanda is important to the rest of the story. For reference, I cut out like 47 chapters in my initial summary, but at least people consider that part canon for the most part.
So, TLDR, the focal point of Paley's interpretation of the Ramayana is a part of the legend that's not even considered canon by a lot of people. What the fuck?
As I said before, Nina's breakup with Dave is sudden. Like, I understand why she wouldn't put the full story in for privacy reasons, and it's her perspective and not his, but something about it feels off.
Maybe it's a metaphor for how Nina is using a rather stunted interpretation of the Ramayana to cope with her breakup bullshit. I don't know.
But after Dave dumps Nina via email, we get this trippy sequence with the only original song in the movie, titled commonly as Sita's Fire. I won't talk too much about it, as I don't want my photosensitive friends to miss anything important. The sequence is well animated, and it definitely paints Nina's inner turmoil once Dave ditches her. But considering we don't know that Rama leaves Sita in a similar manner, does kinda seem like all the Sita and Rama mentions come out of left field.
all we know about the connection at this point is Rama was allegedly distant when he reunited with Sita, much like how Dave was when Nina went to India. Also, both stories involve India. Get it? Also, I noticed Nina used the shadow puppets less during this part of the movie. They comment briefly on Sita's pregnancy and a couple other aspects of the story, but most of the rest of it is told via the retellings and the songs. It's an odd creative choice that stuck out. Maybe they just didn't have much to say about the seventh Khanda? I don't know. During these final musical numbers, we finally see Lakshmana, but we also see...
Too bad, I'm feeling mighty sick.
This is cursed. This pregnancy to design is so fucking cursed. What the hell were you thinking, Nina? For reference, when I saw the posters for this movie, I thought Sita was pregnant to begin with. I didn't know she wasn't until I started my research. This is another repeat of the scene where Rama banishes Sita, but it also gets more cursed.
I ain't deserving of none.
Yeah, no, just no. Here's another problem with this storyline. We're told in the advertising of the trailers that we're gonna see the greatest breakup story ever told, and it's such a feminist retelling showing the breakup of two people from this ancient legend. It's an ancient, legendary breakup. But there is no breakup for most of the movie. And as I said, the Khanda where Rama and Sita do break up is controversial. Did you notice how the film kinda ended perfectly with Rama and Sita's exile ending? It's like someone wrote their own fanfic continuation where they broke up an iconic couple just to meet an agenda. And that's literally the plot of My Inner Life! The rest of the sequences involving Sita are a rehash of what I've said before, only with cursed imagery and a god-awful song that's Nina's interpretation of those Praise Rama songs his kids were taught.
Rama set his wife ablaze, got her home, kicked her out, to allay his people's doubt.
And, well, I got bored. I wanted to fast forward through everything and just get everything done and over with, so I wondered. Why didn't Nina start with the breakup in the first place? Like, the breakup's the biggest straw. That's like the whole point of the film, right? But then I remembered her reasoning behind making a film about the Ramayana.
I was moved by the Ramayana, and it seemed to speak so much to my life at the time, my problems at the time. It was cathartic to retell the story.
And I realized, holy shit, is this literally the My Inner Life of cinema? Some of y'all might not be familiar with the infamous fanfiction My Inner Life. I'm reading it on Fanfiction Theater right now. Or maybe I finished it. I don't know when this video is going to be released, but I have read it or I am currently reading it by the time this video comes out, I promise. If you don't want to suffer, like I had to suffer, here's a TLDR. My Inner Life is a self-insert Legend of Zelda fanfiction written sometime between the late 90s and early 2000s. It follows the adventures of Jenna, who is a self-insert character created by the author, Link's Queen. The story begins with an explanation that Link's Queen slash Jenna became infatuated with Link after playing the Zelda games, to the point where she started to have lucid dreams about him. She was convinced that these were not just dreams, but a second life she was living! An inner life, if you will. Jenna slash Link's Queen in her inner life possessed exceptional beauty and magical abilities. She was a capable, strong, confident woman who also couldn't live without her husbando, Link. Hell, their relationship starts with him calling her pretty and asking her out on a date. Jenna slash Link's Queen also becomes entangled in Hyrule's conflicts, often getting important artifacts without really doing anything, like the Ocarina of Time. No, really. The focal point of the story, though, is the fact Jenna and Link are very much in love and are perfect for each other. There's no Link X Saria, no Link X Rudo, and absolutely no Link X Zelda. All of Jenna's rivals for Link's affection are banished to the realm of minor characters, only popping up if they are directly helping Jenna. Compare this to Nina Paley, Sita Sings the Blues. Nina is a strong, competent woman until her relationship with Dave disintegrates. Hell, she brings it up herself in the Q&A.
Making the film allowed me to get in touch with my inner Sita. I didn't know why I was feeling the way I was feeling, wanting this man who rejected me. A normal, self-assured woman, I related so much to Sita in the Ramayana, and I felt the pain of the failed relationship could consume me if I wasn't careful. Basically, the pain was going to burn me. For me, that's a metaphor of pain. It can either burn you, or it can fuel something.
And look, it's fine to use art to express your feelings. It's perfectly okay to write fan fiction as a means to process stuff you've been through. Hell, I did it myself as a kid. But publicizing that work, especially if it involves a marginalized group, just feels off. While watching Sita Sings the Blues, I compared it to my inner life with my friends. It was all in good fun, especially since both were their own forms of blasphemy. But as I continued my research for this video, I saw a lot more parallels than meets the eye.
We already talked about how Sita Sings the Blues can be seen as a sort of fanfiction, but what else does it have in common with My Inner Life? First things first, the use of a pre-written story as a sort of escapism. Jenna most likely started writing My Inner Life as a way to escape the boringness of real life. She got really into Link and wanted to fantasize about a life with him, regardless of what the rest of the Zelda fandom thought. Nina Paley started reading the Ramayana to cope with her divorce. She saw parts of herself in Sita and wanted to make a feminist retelling of the Ramayana, regardless of what people who actually know the source material thought.
Both pieces of work strive to fix something their respective authors think is broken with the source material, whether it be thinking your lucid dreams were real or seething at the inevitable misogyny of ancient history.
Both works also take excessive liberties with their source material. Jenna makes clear what parts of the Zelda canon she didn't use in her author's notes.
The story takes place after Ocarina of Time. Nothing after that ever happens. No Majora's Mask, no A Link to the Past, or even Oracle of Ages and Seasons.
Sita also takes liberties with its source material.
I didn't set out to tell the Ramayana, only my Ramayana. I wanted to be very clear about my point of view, my biases.
And taking liberties with the source material is fine. That's why fix exist. But warping the source material in a way that's only benefiting yourself, it's just unhealthy.
And speaking of unhealthy, both authors also deflected criticism. Jenna did so rather famously through a very long author's note. Here is an excerpt.
I've gotten way too many flames about the content of this story when I have placed several warnings. I will not accept any more flames, ramblings, cussing, or excessive lashing out about the charred Jenna or abuse about the content of this story. Excessive lashing out, vicious attacks against my personality, or non-mature constructive criticism. Any reviews submitted that do not follow the above guidelines will be deleted immediately. These warnings are not there to look pretty. The authors place warnings for a reason. It is to tell you what the content of the story is, so that if the reader finds the content of the story offensive, they will not read on. Many authors have been complaining about unwanted, excessive, violent, and just plain nasty reviews that have been submitted by readers about their stories, causing fanfiction to grant authors the ability to delete unwanted reviews and block certain readers. I will say this for myself and for all authors on fanfiction. No author twists your arm or holds you at gunpoint or forces you in any way, shape, or form to read their stories. All readers have the right not to read a certain story. It is your responsibility to read the warnings and decide for yourself if the content of the story is offensive to you, and to make the choice to read on or not. And it is also the reader's responsibility to take responsibility on how they handle themselves when leaving a review for an author. Leaving a review that is violent in nature only makes you, the reader, look bad and is very immature. If all us here are supposed to be adults, well then, let's conduct ourselves like adults and not like little kids. I only expect the violent lashing out and vicious attacks to come from teenagers, not adults. If you people really are adults that are conducting yourselves in the manners I described above, you people are really scaring me.
That's only part of like 2.5 pages of complaining. It's hilarious. But Nina also deflected criticism of her work by putting her critics in two camps. Far-right Hindu nationalists and the woke leftists.
There has been plenty of feedback, much less negative than positive, but the negative things are more notable. And I get it both from the far right and the far left. The far right, they say that they're Hindus, but I think it's not right to call them Hindus. They think nonviolence is bullshit. Don't think you can walk all over Hindus, we'll violate your ass. They send me things letting me know that. On the far left, there are some very, very privileged people in academia who have reduced all the wondrous complexities of racial relations into white people are racist and non-white people are all victims of white racism. Without actually looking at the work, they decided that any white person doing a project like this is by definition racist, and it's an example of more neocolonialism. So politics makes strange bedfellows.
Nina, leftists aren't mad at you for making a film about the Ramayana. They're mad at you for making a film about the Ramayana as a way to talk about your divorce. And also because you're a transphobic hack. I don't think India needs a white lady to make a film inserting her personal drama into an important story from their culture. Fuck, I just spent months on a video to come to an easy conclusion. What the fuck am I doing with my life? There's not much else in the film I can really talk about without sounding like a broken record. I think I gave this film a fair chance despite its creator and came to the conclusion that it's not just cultural appropriation, it's not just wish fulfillment, but it's literally fan fiction. This is just a weird white woman's fan fiction of a different culture's most important story to try and get over her divorce. And again, that's fine as long as you don't publicize it. If you do, you're the one responsible for all the self-serving shit that's in your work. You're the one who has to answer for the blatant historical inaccuracies. You are the one who is accountable for the mistakes. And if you can't admit that your magnum opus is just fan fiction, then you're kind of a coward. But with that, I take my leave. Good night, and goodbye. I don't remember what side I did, so I'm gonna do both.